So guys, this is Gordon again, and last week's video, I'm really happy because you guys left a lot of comments telling me that my videos are really helpful. That really means a lot to me. Honestly, those comments make my day. The fact that you guys leave comments and telling me those good things, I'm really happy, to be honest. It made me excited to actually make this video. You see the background is a bit different. It's because, well, today is pretty hectic. I have my EU law examinations in 3 days, so I can't need to go out and study. Long story short, today I'm going to make a video about how to ace law school, and I'll give you 5 or 6 tips. Because when I was in my first year, I did really horribly, to be honest. Like, my first year result, it was like almost like a 2-2. And I actually doubted whether I could actually become a lawyer. Later on, I realized some of the techniques to study for my law school. And later on, I got Danish for 2 years in a row. And also, I got into Cambridge. And today, I'm just gonna tell you all my secrets. Those tips are exactly how I studied in the past years. Even today, even the past year when I did the New York Bar Exam, I still use those techniques to study. So I think no matter you're in a GDL, you're doing your law school, you're doing even non-law subjects, doing your LPC, I think you will find this video helpful. The first one is more about your mindset. Aim as high as possible. Maybe you don't actually aim a first or whatever. Just listen, you need to aim so hard. If in UK maybe, you need to aim to score 80, even though 70 is a first. Why? Because when you aim as high as possible, you're gonna over prepare. You're gonna study as many materials as possible to ensure that you can reach that level. In my first year of law school, I didn't aim that hard. I just wanted to get maybe a 2-1, and end up I almost get a 2-2. Because the moment that you aim a 2-1, you will feel like you don't need to work that hard. You don't need to study that much because you are not aiming at a first. It will make you lazier. The fact that you aim so hard, you will over prepare. Maybe at the end, you still don't get the first you want, or you still don't reach that highest mark you're aiming at. But it doesn't matter because you tend to do way better than you would have been if you just aimed at a 2-1 rather than at first. Not even comparing to others, but just be the best version of myself to do whatever it takes to score the highest possible mark I could possibly achieve if I studied as hard as possible. Before I'm going to give you my second tips, I think I kind of need to change because I'm pretty in a hurry to study in the coffee shop in the afternoon. It's my schedule today. Wait for a bit. Some of you guys may wonder why you need to study in a coffee shop. I mean, you can study at home, right? Actually, this is also one of my little hacks for studying for law school. Personally, I love studying in different locations throughout the day. Like in the morning, I may study at home. In the afternoon, I may go to a coffee shop or go to the library to study. And then at night, I may come back to my apartment to study. This is the habit I have been using for the past 4 or 5 years. And recently I found out there's actually science behind that. Studying in different locations can provide your brain with more memory clues to retrieve those information later on, so that it helps you memorize the materials better. Well, in London, I usually go to Foyles or Waterstone, which are my favorite spots in London. I go there so often that the staff there actually remember what I'm gonna order every time, that I'm gonna order iced latte. So here's my second tips. You need to go beyond the course materials in order to stand out. What does that mean? So firstly, at the beginning of every semester, basically your professor will send you a lot of materials about your law course. They will give you lots of like recommended reading, compulsory readings, any other materials or books for you to read in order to be successful in that course or to understand the subject better. However, that means every single one of you are gonna read the same material and use the same material in the examination. So that's the problem, because how can you distinguish yourself from others in an examination that everyone is basically using the same thing? Of course, there are some students who may have a better analytical skills. However, in general, it's still so hard for one candidate to stand out by just reading the materials provided by your professor. For me personally, I tried to read around the subject. I tried to go beyond the course materials provided by my professors. One of the effective ways is to actually read journal articles in that areas of law, so that you can actually name drop some of the scholars of that journal articles and use the arguments in your questions, in the examination questions. Even in problem questions, you can also use those arguments.
So I'll just demonstrate. For example, if you're gonna study like competition law, so you type competition law Article 102, so competition law article 102 journal PDF, so that when you search this kind of thing, usually you will see a lot of like articles.
Additionally, you can also check out resources like LexisNexis, Westlaw, or High Online. In those websites, you can basically find a lot of legal journals relating to different topics. Alternatively, you can also use some new cases or decisions just laid down by the court, because usually we focus a lot on old cases or the cases that the professor assigned to you. However, we can actually discover some new cases in that areas of law and use those new cases. Maybe they offer a newer legal perspective to that area so that you can use that argument. Using those resources is very important, because usually when it comes to examinations, the professor is gonna read the same arguments, same cases every time. However, if you name drop a case or a journal articles or a scholarly arguments that are pretty new to the professor and it makes sense and it's a logical argument, then you will definitely get some extra bonus point for your arguments and you will definitely stand out from the crowd in an examination. So this is my second tips.
Okay, before I head off, I'm going to give you my third tips. Loads of practices. Well, basically, the actual examination date shouldn't be the first time you take that examination.
What does that mean?
You only have one exam for each subject, right? So it makes sense that that should be your first time to take that examination. But listen to me. I'll use my experience as examples. When I take the New York bar exam, I need to answer 100 multiple choice questions in 3 hours. I also have to answer 6 problem questions in 3 hours as well. But before the examination, I already did 1,500 multiple choice questions and I finished over 50 problem questions before I entered into the examination hall. Other people may think that this was the first time I actually took the exam, but deep down I knew I took the exams over 20 times in the past before I actually took the actual examination. The same applies to every examination. When I studied my undergraduate law degree, I did a lot of past papers. Some of the universities, they may provide their students with lots of past paper questions. And more often than not, the questions are gonna repeat again and again in the coming years. Of course, they won't appear in the exact same fashion. However, they kinda tend to test very similar concepts or use pretty similar facts. Bearing in mind that professors are very busy, they're not going to create innovative or like crazy questions every and each year. Even though your university may not necessarily provide you with so many past paper questions, nowadays, you go to Google, there's so many online resources out there to help you. And you could actually even buy books, like Q&A books for each subject, and they actually provide you with some sample questions and model answers. So I'm gonna demonstrate again. For example, my EU law exam, the BPP law school only provides me with like 50 sample questions. So I'm gonna search online to see whether there are other questions. So when I type, for example, I type EU law multiple choice questions, I can already immediately find some sample multiple choice questions. For example, this website. Let's see, I can actually find different chapters. I can actually do more multiple choice questions online before my actual examination. And before I enter into the examination hall, I already finished more than 100 multiple choice questions. And the actual examination, I need to answer like 50 questions. That's what it means by preparation and practice. Another aspect of practice is timing. In the past, the exams that I did really well were those exams that I could actually finish them in time. And that is so important. I remember when I was in my first year, I did horribly in my tort law examination. I didn't understand why, because I literally gave the best possible answer for one of those questions in the exam. Later, I realized that while I gave the perfect answer for one of those questions, I didn't actually manage to finish the other two questions. So I realized one thing. Being able to give 3 equally good answers is actually better than being able to give 1 perfect answer and 2 inferior answers. It actually also traces back to my first point about practicing. Because as long as you practice many past paper questions or sample questions, you will more likely be able to manage your time efficiently. Imagine if you have already done the examination for more than 10 times, you probably know how much you need to write in an examination. So try to do a simulated examination beforehand. Just find some practice questions, maybe 2 or 3, and then force yourself to finish them within 3 hours to see whether you can manage to finish them. This is really important. And I always think that doing past paper questions or practice questions is really useful for your revision as well. Because sometimes when you read a lot of materials, you can't really put them in practice. But by attempting questions, you actually know what areas of law you're not really that familiar with, so that you also know your weaknesses and also strengths by doing a lot of past paper questions.
And another little tips is, sometimes you also want to study different subjects throughout the day. Don't study exclusively on just one subject. There are actually signs proving that if you study different subjects across the day, maybe like 2 or 3 subjects, in the morning, afternoon, and at night, actually it helps you learn faster. Now I will let you know how you can actually achieve a better structure by reading some like Q&A books.
So right now I'm in FOIL. Let's take a look. There are actually so many like Q&As. EU law. Q&A. That's what I need. So guys, you should check out these kind of Q&A books, because usually they will give you some sample questions, but the answers are not that important. The important part is you should actually know how they present their answers and their structure. They will give you an idea of how to structure your answer in an actual examination. You should learn from them, and they are pretty useful resources for you. You can literally just borrow them or like read them in FOILs or any kind of libraries. It's quite easily accessible to you guys, so do check them out. There are lots of these kind of books for you. I feel nauseous, believe me. Never had a lot of shit come easy. Had to work hard, struggle just to be me. Had to rise up just so they could see me. Did what I had to do just to feed me, and what was left over I put towards my dreaming. But the only thing in life that has meaning are the things you gotta work for, believe me. Take into your hands up. After coming back from FOILs, I'm going to give you my 4th tips. So the 4th tips is this: the lecture looks your lecturer give you shouldn't be the notes you use for the preparation of your examination. I remember when I studied in my law school, one of my criminal professors once said this: an amazing set of notes prepared by someone else is no better than an inferior set of notes prepared by you. Everyone has different preferences for how their notes should be organized. That's why it's really important for you to use notes that are tailored to your needs. Some people, they may love lengthy or wordy notes and it works for them, and some people, they may love graphs or like tables, etc., so that it helps them memorize the stuff. For example, this is the set of notes I use. Put star on it when it's an important concept, and also I will use different styles of highlight pens. For example, the words highlight in orange are like concepts that I need to know, and highlight in yellow a specific concept that I must remember for the bar exam, and the words highlight in green are usually some key examples that are often used in an exam question, so that I categorize different colors so that it reminds me of different things when I study for my bar exam. When I finish a past paper questions and I find that that question is a bit tricky, I will incorporate that concept into my notes. For example, I revise something about robbery, and if the victim laughs or it's not put in fear, it's no robbery. This is one of the tricky bar exam questions I encountered in the past. Sometimes you also want to rewrite some of the concepts and reproduce them into like tables so that it helps you memorize the stuff. If you realize that the notes made by you could not actually be understood by anyone else, that means you're doing something right. That means your notes are really tailored to your specific needs, and only you can understand this set of notes in the entire world. So that's why sometimes when like people, they kind of want to borrow notes from others, I don't think it's a good idea, because that set of notes does not necessarily work for you. It works for that person. And my last tips for studying for the law school is this: teach someone else some law subject. What does that mean? It sounds so weird, because whenever I encounter some really difficult concepts in law, I'll actually reach out to some of my friends. They don't actually study law, so that I can explain to them a complicated legal concepts. As I communicate those concepts to them, I actually learn those concepts even better. And the crazier thing is that I will even explain those concepts to them in Cantonese rather than in English. That means I have to understand those concepts really clearly in English so that I could do it in another language as well. So for people who are bilingual, you should definitely try this out.
偷嘢其中一個元素就是你要永久地褫奪他人的財產，你拎了別人的東西之後，你打算之後再還給他，這樣算不算永久地褫奪他人的財產呢？
But sometimes, you know, like everyone is busy and it's difficult for you to find someone to talk to about like these kind of things. And well, I know how it feels. I mean, as you study law, you have learned that there's this hypothetical reasonable person. Just pretend you're talking to such a person. When you're alone in a room, just read the information out loud and try to pretend someone is listening to you and then tell him or teach him a subject or a concept that he doesn't understand. I also did that as well, and I think it's pretty useful. Especially you need to read those information out loud, because there are actually studies showing that whenever you read the information out loud, you actually learn better compared to you just reading the information silently. So I think it's a good idea for you to actually read those information out loud and speaking out loud to a hypothetical person sitting in front of you. So guys, this is basically the end of my video about the tips for nailing law school. I hope you guys find it useful. I probably need to start like studying harder for my EU law examination. And by the time when I release this video, I probably only have one day left. So pray for me. Hopefully I will pass. I recently reached 1,000 subscribers. And for me, I'm really proud of having 1,000 of you guys watching my videos. Although some people, they have like millions of people, whatever. I don't care. You need to compare it to yourself. And for me, 1,000 people is a lot already. So I'm really proud of having you guys like watching my videos like on a weekly basis. If you love my content and also if you enjoy watching this video, leave a comment and let me know. I really appreciate your feedback. Yeah, also let me know what you wanna watch next, and probably the next video will be the legal tech. I also have one video in mind, is that 5 things you can do if you graduate but you don't have a training contract or pupillage, whatever. This is also one video that I think is pretty interesting, because I actually was in such a position. I graduated without training contract and I need to figure out what I had to do in that one whole year period. And I find out that in the legal industry, there's so many possibilities, and even outside the legal industry, there's so many possibilities. So that I think it's good for me to share my experiences with you guys and what things you can do for your career if you still haven't reached your goal at this point of your life. Anyway, thank you so much guys for watching this video. I will see you guys next time. Bye.